So good evening. Welcome to the IMS public lecture this evening. My name is Dr. Tan, I'm the director of Public Institutes. The IMS public lecture series is funded by the Hong Kong Memorial Fund, and it provides opportunities for the institute to invite outstanding individuals to come and deliver public lecture to members of the public. And this evening we have, we are very fortunate to have Professor Gunther Uhlmann from the University of Washington to be the speaker for the public lecture. Professor Uhlmann received his PhD in 1976 from MIT and has held teaching positions at both Harvard and MIT, and currently is Walker Family Endowed Chair at the University of Washington, and concurrently he is also Shi Yuan Professor of Mathematics at the Institute for Advanced Studies at the Hong Kong University of Science and Technology. Professor Uhlmann is an outstanding applied mathematician. He has received many prizes. Let me just name a few. He received the Pulitzer Prize from the American Mathematical Society for outstanding or significant contributions to the field of IMS problems and partial differential equations. So that was in 2011, and during the same year, he also received the Carnegie Prize from the Society for Industrial and Applied Mathematics. He was the Rothschild Distinguished Visiting Fellow at the Newton Institute. That was in 2013. And last year, he received the Solomon Lectures Medal from the Mathematical Council of the Americas. And of course, I should also mention that he is currently a distinguished visitor to the Institute for Mathematical Sciences, participating at a program on inverse mathematics, inverse problems, organized by the IMS. So this evening, he will give a lecture. The title is Inverse Problems and Harry Potter's Cloak. It's a very intriguing topic, and please welcome Professor Uhlmann.
Thank you very much, Director, for a very kind introduction. It's a great pleasure for me to be in Singapore. As I have said several times, Singapore has a special place in my heart. My family lives here. I have two grandchildren here and one on the way. And I thank IMS for inviting me to give this lecture, and for organizing the Inverse Problems Conference, and last week tutorial. So the topic is about inverse problems. The question is whether you can find something inside an object by just making measurements outside. And the opposite side of the coin is, which is very related to inverse problems, is whether you can hide something, you can make something, an object invisible. So that's the Harry Potter's cloak. So let me start with inverse problems. It's in very brief summary, seeing the unseen. So it's very hard to define what an inverse problem is, but in a direct problem, you usually send waves through a medium, through an object, and you can predict the response. And an inverse problem is the opposite. You send some waves, this is known, to the medium, and you measure some properties of the response. You measure the response as much as you can, and from that information, you try to recover the medium. And the inverse problems arise in all fields of science and technology, even in our daily life, we solve problems. But let me start with waves. I send waves, and waves are everywhere. We have the familiar ocean waves and waves in a pond, and ripples when you throw a stone in a pond. But there are waves that we have created, conceptual waves, electromagnetic waves that occur. For instance, your cell phones are receiving waves right now. They are, I want to talk more about these electromagnetic waves. You're hearing me. There are waves propagating through here, sound waves, many kinds of different ways, and we are going to see this throughout the lecture. In a wave, it's a very important concept, is the wavelength, is the distance. So you imagine a wave like in this form. This is the distance between the crests, is called the wavelength. And different, for instance, for light, when you have a prism here, refracts into different colors. It's like a rainbow. This was discovered by Newton. So red and violet have very different wavelengths, and the inverse of the wavelengths, the reciprocal, is called the frequency. So these are very low frequency, much higher frequency here. So this is an important concept in the scientific version of waves. And we solve problems, inverse problems, all the time. An example is vision. In this case, the waves are electromagnetic waves, they're light. And from the reflection of the light in our retinas, so we can find, we can see, and we get the information about the world. So the measurements are in our retina, and our brain builds a three-dimensional map of the scene. And visual processing, what we do, how do we do this, occupies a large part of our brain. And of course, we would like to understand how our brain does this, and this is a big field in neuroscience, and it has applications in many things, artificial intelligence and so on. Other living creatures find another way to, for instance, capture their food. Dolphins use acoustic waves. It's very dark in the ocean. You cannot see. You cannot send electromagnetic waves. They send sound waves, and for the echo produced, they create an image, and in that way they can find their prey. So the question is, can we build equipment to do the same? And we have accomplished this. It's called sonar. For different wavelengths, bats do exactly the same. Of course, they cannot find their way with light, they find their way with sound. But in this case, the wavelengths is much shorter, the frequency is much higher, and again they measure the echo, and from that information they can create an image and capture their prey or find their food. This process occupies a large part of the brains of these mammals, dolphins and bats, and also whales do exactly the same. Again, different frequencies of the whales, different wavelengths. So we did build equipment to do this. It's called sonar. And this is, for instance, how the Titanic was found. You send sound waves, and then from the image, from the reflection that you get at the surface of the ocean in the ship, you create this image, and this is the way that the ship was found. And that was not so long ago. And electromagnetic waves, different frequencies again, radar, this used all the time to find planes or other objects. You send electromagnetic waves again, and you measure the reflection, and from that information you want to locate the object, where it is, their shape, and so on. And this is used every day now. So sonar and radar are examples of equipment that we have built to solve inverse problems. Another source of important source of impact problems is medical imaging. You don't want to do an operation on humans if there is a problem. So you make measurements on the outside, and this was a big accomplishment that led to the development of CT scans. You have a source of X-rays, and X-rays are very high frequency electromagnetic waves. They have very small wavelengths, and they travel approximately in a straight line. So when you have a source of X-rays and a detector of X-rays, you move the source around, the detector around, and the problem is, can you recover the properties of this medium, the density in particular, from the how much these X-rays are attenuated when they go through the body. And this problem was solved mathematically a long time ago by Radon, and this is a CT scan, and you can have very detailed pictures of, for instance, the brain. And as I said, the mathematician solved this problem of trying to find the density from the attenuation of X-rays. It didn't have applications until many years later, until the 60s, and Cormack and Hounsfield were the first to actually develop CT scans practically. And they received the Nobel Prize in Medicine for this, because that revolutionized medicine. You don't have just X-rays, you can take X-rays in many directions, and from that information you can find whether there is a problem, there is a tumor, or things of this sort. And a discrete example of what we have here is the following. You have an X-ray source, it travels in straight lines, and here is the detector, and what you're measuring in rough terms is the sum of the values here of this square. So in this case, for instance, is, if I cannot see very well without my glasses, 4 plus 4 plus 5, 13, and this line is 8, and so on. It's like a Sudoku, and from this sum, this, you try to find what are these numbers here. So you're solving a Sudoku, and that's more or less what's happening when you're trying to find what is inside from attenuation of X-rays. And there are other medical imaging methods that are very important. Another one is magnetic resonance imaging, where you measure the response to a very strong gravitational field. Magnetic field. And then, for instance, you create here very detailed image. I don't know where you can see the bones on the knee. I had an MRI. The young people here probably haven't had one. It's extremely useful medical imaging technique, very powerful. And also, the development of MRI received the Nobel Prize in Medicine in 2003. And another medical imaging method that uses a different type of waves at different wavelengths is ultrasound. The ultrasound is like, it uses the same principle as bats. You send very high frequency waves, and you measure the echoes, and from these echoes, you create an image of the inside. And that's a standard procedure now for pregnant women to see how the baby is developing. Okay, so this is in medical imaging, but also in seismology, in geophysics, this solving the problems all the time. We have not been able to realize Julius Verne's dream of going through the center of the Earth. How do we find what is in the interior of the Earth, how the inner core of the Earth looks like, and so on? It's only from indirect information, and earthquakes are the sound of the earth in many ways, give that information. So you measure how much time does it take to go from one seismic station to the other. And from that information, you try to find this structure here. This is an earthquake. I come from a from a country that has had, from Chile, I was born in Chile, that has had many earthquakes. In fact, the largest earthquake ever recorded was in Chile, was in 1960, was 9.5 in the Richter scale. That completely changed the geography of Chile. So in earthquakes, you have an epicenter here, and then the waves move, and then some of the waves will penetrate through the inner core of the Earth, the interior of the Earth, and the information that they give, the travel time, for instance, is then allows us to recover the structure inside. And this is a movie of what happens with waves. And you have seismic waves. Some of them, these are called compressional waves, don't penetrate the inner core, but the ones who move slower do penetrate and give information to this part of the Earth. So that's the way we can find what is inside the Earth, and this is being applied to other planets like Mars. There has been a lot of information coming from Mars because of the recent probes that have been sent there. This is a cartoon of the tsunami that happened in the earthquake, 1960 earthquake in Chile. This is Chile, South America. This is a very long and narrow country. And the epicenter of the earthquake was near the Valdivia, which is in the south of Chile, and produced a tremendous tsunami, perhaps the largest ever, that produced earthquakes throughout the Pacific, in particular in Japan. Okay, and astrophysics and cosmology also is another source of inverse problems. You want to find, how do we find what happened in the past in the universe? The Big Bang, for instance, or the structure near a black hole, or so on. We receive information from the past. We receive, we see light, and this light may be, have taken billions of years to arrive to the Earth. And the question is, from this light that we receive near the Earth on satellites and so on, and telescopes, can we find what happened in the past? So can we determine the structure of space-time when we see light coming from many point sources? So we have done several works in this direction. So astrophysics, all the information that we get is indirect. We cannot make really measurements of what happens in the past, but we see light, and now we have other types of waves, which are gravitational waves that were found 3 years ago, were predicted by Einstein, the theory of relativity, and then this is the movie provided by NSF of the discovery. Two black holes collided, and they created a very strong wave that produced ripples through space-time, like a stone in a pond, and that gives us also information of what happened in the past. Okay, so I'm starting to look a little bit more about invisibility. Our work on invisibility came by studying an inverse problem, which is called electrical impedance tomography, EIT, or Calderon's problem in the mathematical literature. And the question is different than X-rays. Can one recover the electrical conductivity? What is electrical conductivity? The electrical conductivity measures how much electricity can go from one place to the other. So, for instance, water is very highly conducting, copper, and so on. Can you determine the inside, the conductivity inside, by putting electrodes around the body and measure the voltage and current? Okay, so currents are very different than X-rays. They travel all over the place. So it's very diffuse information. Calderon was a famous mathematician of the 20th century. He thought about this for oil prospection, to find oil, because oil has a very different conductivity than the surrounding rock, but has been proposed as an early method for breast cancer detection, because normal breast tissue has much lower conductivity than the cancerous breast tumor. So there is a big difference, big contrast between the tumor, cancerous tumors, and normal breast tissue. And the reason is that blood is very highly conducting and cancer needs blood to grow. So that is reflected in this contrast and conductivity, and we want to find it by making measurements on the outside of the body, putting electrodes like in EKG outside of the body. This is a cartoon of what Calderon considered in all his prospections. You put electrodes here, and this is oil. You draw a well, and then you want to find this by making measurements just here. As I said, oil has a very different conductivity than the surrounding medium. And for breast cancer, you put electrodes on one side, you compress the breast, and then you try to infer whether it's a tumor or not. The cannot sometimes cannot be found by mammograms, because X-rays sometimes don't, especially in young women, cannot distinguish whether it's cancer or not. But electrical methods may be better, because they can measure whether there is blood going to the tumor or not. This is Calderon. These are another picture of the currents, but all over the place. It's a different kind of method. And a discrete model of this is a network. You have resistors here, and you measure voltages and currents on the nodes outside. Not inside, only outside, and from that information you try to infer what the resistances here are. The resistance is the inverse of the conductivity, so it's the same information. So it's like internet. It's a very similar problem when you have many connections and you try to infer them by making measurements just outside. Okay, this is an example of a fish. Electrical fish who can find their way around using electrical methods. These fishes cannot sense sound, they cannot see anything, so they use electrical methods to find their prey. Here food will be thrown, and they have sensors in their skin that can measure the difference in potential, and then they come back to capture the fish. They are very interesting animals, and there was a talk today in the conference about how the fishes do this mathematically. And this is an example of how the fish is noting the difference in the conductivity or the voltage when you get close to the prey. Okay, so there are many methods. I just talking about that. This is another example of EIT. Here are the electrodes. It's a very safe method. This is David Isaacson, who has been one of the proponents of this method. And you can see that when the blood comes in or out of the lungs. And this is important for monitoring continuously whether the lung has collapsed or not after an operation. The resolution is not good, but you can see whether a lung has collapsed or not. So this is okay. So there are many different kinds of inverse problems. I just touched on some of them, applications in many fields. And now I go to the other side of the coin, which is making objects invisible. In inverse problem, you try to find what is inside by making measurements outside. In invisibility, we want to hide completely an object from any kind of measurements. How do we do that? How do we build Harry Potter's cloak? And I want to show you how to do. Of course, invisibility has been a subject of interest to humans for a long time, thousands of years, at least since the Greeks, Perseus versus Medusa, and so on. And of course, it has been the subject of science fiction, movies, and so on. Let me show some clips of recent movies that are relevant to the scientific description or study of invisibility. Okay, invisibility is coming. So the first clip that you saw is by H.G. Wells, from H.G. Wells, the famous novel, The Invisible Man. And you see, this is what I talk about at the beginning, the way you see it is by the reflection of light in your eye, or a scattering or something of this sort. But if the light propagates in a straight line, it's like air, so you make what's called the index of refraction. I'm going to talk about this. The properties to refract light, to reflect light, everybody has different properties, every medium. You make that the same as of air, then the rays of light will go straight through, and this will become invisible. You see the cloth, because the cloth have not changed the index of refraction. It has the same, it's the same as before, so they reflect and then you can see it. But if it is the same as air, if the index of refraction is the same as of air, then the rays of light will go straight through. And the way that the invisible man does this, we want to know how to do this, is by a chemical procedure. He was a chemist that changed the index of refraction of his body. And that's highly dangerous and not recommended, and is not going to succeed most likely, because the human body is very heterogeneous, but this is the idea of changing the index of refraction is a good one. The second clip that you saw was about the invisible woman, and this is from the comics, Susan Storm Richards from the Fantastic Four. Actually, my son was the one who pointed this to me when I told him about how the ideas behind invisibility. So she makes herself invisible by creating a field around her that deflects light. So light will not be reflected from her, will be going somewhere else, will be deflected. A very strong field of energy, it's very powerful, but we are not told how to build it. So the idea of deflecting light is a good one. And Star Trek, they have a more scientific idea of how to do it. They use gravitons. Gravitons is something that comes up in general relativity. In the Einstein's theory of relativity, you have a very strong gravitational field deflects light. This is what Einstein's theory predicts. You have a very strong mass, very large mass, very strong gravitational field will warp space and light will be deflected. So they put gravitons, which create a very strong gravitational field around the ship, and that will deflect light. It's a very, very nice idea, but how to do it in practice? How do we create these gravitons here, these strong gravitational fields? So this is what we are going to try to do, but there is an analogy with relativity. And the way we are going to do it is a la Harry Potter. So we are going to build the cloak around us in such a way that light will be deflected, and as in the case of the Invisible Woman or Star Trek, or the ship in Star Trek, will be deflected, and when you see it, it will look like it went straight through like Invisible Man. So we are going to create a cloak, a certain material that will deflect light around to make the object invisible. So the idea of Harry Potter is also a good one. But how to do it, how to build it scientifically? This is, of course, I should make a demonstration of me making myself invisible. This is half invisible. Another one, my hand invisible, and so on. Of course, animals and living creatures try this all the time to protect themselves or to find prey. For instance, this is camouflage. This looks very much like the surrounding medium. Of course, we cannot do that. And you can always make yourself invisible by just putting mirrors in special places, and magicians use this a lot of the time. You send a reflection of light somewhere else, so you're not seen. This is half, you can see half of the body here, but in principle you can make it completely invisible in one direction by just putting mirrors in different places. I was at the Science Center of Singapore last weekend, and they have a demonstration of this. And they have also very nice maze of mirrors with a lot of reflections and so on. Very nice. So this is what I mentioned before. You can always make something invisible by mirrors in one direction. So this is the bag that you want to make invisible. You put mirrors in particular places. And then when this see the other bag, doesn't see this at all. It's completely invisible in that direction. What you want to do is to make things invisible in every possible direction. And also you cannot carry mirrors all over the place. How do you do it so that it works in every possible situation? And the idea, one of the scientific ideas, perhaps the main one, is called transformation optics. And there were two articles in Science that received a lot of attention on invisibility by Penry et al., and the related article by Ulf Leonhardt that use transformations. I will explain what this is. And actually, our work on invisibility was studying an inverse problem, Calderon's problem that I mentioned before. Can you recover the conductivity inside by making electrical measurements outside? And we use exactly the same method as Penry. And Science magazine has a very nice description, very accurate description of the ideas behind transformation optics, the ultimate camouflage. The real breakthrough may lie in the theoretical tools used to make the cloak. Such transformation optics researchers imagine a la Einstein warping. So this is the idea, you want to warp space like the Star Trek to bend the path of electromagnetic waves. So you want to deflect light. The mathematical transformation then tells them how to mimic the bending by filling and warp space with the material whose optical properties vary from point to point. That means change the index of refraction. The technique could be used to design antennas, shields, and other devices. Any way you look at it, the ideas behind invisibility are likely to cast a long shadow. You don't want a shadow for invisibility. If you have a shadow, you can tell something about the object. No shadows, no scattering, no reflections, nothing. So this is a cartoon from the paper of Penry et al. So Harry Potter is in this ball, orange ball. And this is the cloak, the blue part. So I'm taking a section. And what we want to do is to put a material here in the blue part so that the rays of light will be deflected like this. And this will become invisible. When you look on the other side, it looks like the rays of light went straight through, like in the case of the invisible man. So how to build this cloak? This is what we want to do. This is Harry Potter's cloak. And what we did in the paper of with Grindin and Lassas was to do this for the currents. On the left, you have a picture, see the conductivity. Remember, conductivity measures how much electricity is being conducting from one place to the other. It's like air. The currents will go straight through. So what we built here is a material conductivity so that the currents go around. When you make measurements outside, it looks exactly like the picture on the left. So you cannot distinguish between this picture, making everything that you put here invisible to electrical measurements. So as I said earlier, the ideas behind invisibility, there is an analogy with relativity, bending light. We want to bend light, and Einstein, one of the main points of Einstein's theory is that if you have a strong mass like the sun, light will be deflected. Space-time will warp. So light will go around, will not travel in a straight line, will be deflected around the object. And for instance, when you see a star, it's not in the position that it actually is, because light had been deflected. So we want to create that effect, but without the gravitational field. We don't have that. And another example is of Einstein's theory of relativity is a black hole, where you have a very strong gravitational field, light will be trapped. Okay, this is the event horizon here. So after it passes here, light will be trapped. It cannot come out. That's why it's called a black hole. So what we want to create is the opposite effect, but for light, in optics, which is a white hole going around. Light will be deflected going around so that this object will be invisible. Okay, so I talk a lot about the index of refraction. I will give very few equations. This is one, it's a very simple one. What is the index of refraction? Is the speed of light in vacuum, in air, essentially air, divided by the speed of light in the medium. So every medium has a very different speed of light. And we want to use that. For instance, air has very close to vacuum. Water has very different index of refraction than air. And diamond, for instance, has very high index of refraction. And the beautiful properties of diamonds come because of this. So when you have reflection, you have reflection of light, depending on the index of refraction, air, water, light will be refracted this way, and part will be reflected, and so on. And what is light has been of interest to humans also for a long time. Light, the Fermat's principle, tries to go in the minimum amount of time possible, but that depends on the speed of light in the medium. And this is an example where the index of refraction goes from very small to very high. So the speed of light is the opposite, goes high to low. So the rays of light will be deflected here in order to go from point A to point B in the minimum amount of time possible. So light tries to go as fast as possible. And that Fermat principle explains many things. For instance, the breaking of a straw in a glass of water, you see the straw being broken, because it refracts this way. The air has a different index of refraction, and when you see the fish is in a different direction, is a different position where it actually is. Very similar when you have a strong gravitational field. So the gravitational field is very similar to the index of refraction. There is an analogy there. And this effect that I mentioned before, very low index of refraction to higher, is holds in every hot surface. In Singapore, I'm sure this happens. You see spots of water in the road, because it varies from very low to very high. And when you think you're seeing water, you're actually seeing the sky, because the rays of light have been deflected because of this index of refraction. Okay, so now I come to the idea of transformation optics. So we want to find an index of refraction so that the rays of light will be deflected. So this is the fish that we want to make invisible, this blue fish. How do we do it? So the idea is, this is a very simple idea. This is virtual space and this is physical space where we are. The idea is very simple. A point in a space is invisible. You cannot see a point. So what I'm going to do is transform this ball here where the fish is to a point. I'm going to collapse it so that this becomes a point. And the laws of physics are the same in different transformation. It doesn't matter whether you take this coordinate system or that coordinate system, the laws of physics are the same. So you cannot distinguish between these two pictures. So I'm transforming this to a point, and therefore I will make everything here invisible because it corresponds to a point. And you can see here by this transformation, the straight lines here, light travels in a straight line, are curved around. And this is the effect that we want to create. So what I'm going to do is make a transformation of this ball, like a football, to a point, or where Harry Potter is, to a point. I'm going to collapse it, and that's called transformation optics. So let me show you a movie where it's the opposite effect. The point is transformed into a ball. So you take the point, and then you can see the rays of light curving around this object. And that's transformation optics. You're using the transformation, you're collapsing this to a point. Or the other way around, you take a point and you blow it up to this medium. And that's a very simple idea. And very general, you don't need to have a ball. You can have other shapes, like us, and collapse it, and then you can make it invisible. So besides the ray theory of light, there is a wave theory of light, saying that was Maxwell was the one who synthesized electricity and magnetism, one of the great triumphs of science, I would say civilization, that has tremendous applications, computers, cellular phones, radio, television, and so on. So he postulated that light was a wave and has two parts, an electrical part and a magnetic part. And the properties of every medium has electrical properties, magnetic properties, and the index of refraction, which I talk about, is related to both. Okay, so Maxwell also found that the speed of these waves is the speed of light. Tremendous discovery. Okay, and using that transformation and the wave theory of light, we can find exactly what the electrical permittivity, this is tells about electrical properties, the magnetic properties. This is the other equation I'm going to write related to the radius of these balls. We know exactly, the only point I want you to remember, exactly, we have a formula, we have a blueprint to what the index of refraction has to be for to have this effect. Light will go around, or the conductivity here will go around, the currents will go around. And when you observe it on the other side, it looks the same as they would go in a straight line. So we have a blueprint, theoretical blueprint, by doing this transformation. We transform this to a point. And this is a simulation based on our work for the waves. You want to do it for the waves, not just the rays. And this is the case coming from one direction, but you can do this from any direction. So the waves will be deflected here. And when you look on the other side, it looks like nothing happened. It went straight through, making everything here completely invisible. This is the idea of transformation optics. Fancy name for a very simple thing. You do a transformation, the laws of physics should not depend on the transformation, doesn't depend on the coordinates that you use. So, okay, so since I'm running out of time, let me jump a little bit. You can do many things with the idea of transformation optics, many things, and I will mention some of them. You can transform an object into other. I can make myself look like somebody else. For instance, I can make myself look like George Clooney. It's an illusion, it's not true. By just using the transformation, this is real space and this is illusion space. And this was proposed by some physicists, Hongyu Liu, who is in this conference in mathematics. This is illusion device, and this is, of course, you do a transformation to do this. So the days of plastic surgery are over. Are counted, no, I shouldn't say over, counted. Just joking. Okay, so there is a question of whether you can do this. This is the theory, very simple theory. This is what the science describes as the mathematical theory, transformation, warping space. You want to warp space. The way we do this is by using the transformation. The question is, can you build this cloak? This is, of course, the practical question. We know how to, theoretically what it should be. And this is under the umbrella of metamaterials, beyond materials. Meta means beyond. And this has been a big subject in material science in the last decade or even more. And science named it one of the insights of the from 2000 to 2010. So we have found ways to manipulate light, at least materials that will manipulate light. One of them is a cloak. We want to build a cloak. Can we do it? Of course, you cannot find a material that will have the properties that you want because it will be invisible. Right? You want to make something invisible. How do you, in nature, this one will not be found. So we had to build it. Okay, so the first, I think the largest success so far in building this has been for acoustics, for sound. We can create the perfect sound hole. The same ideas, this applies to acoustic waves, electromagnetic waves, and other types of waves. So the sound waves will go around here, this is the concert hall, not penetrate, and nothing from the concert hall will go outside. And the group of Chang at Berkeley, who is now president of Hong Kong University, has built with very simple materials, plastic and which holds in particular places these metamaterials that will make sound waves go around. This is based on the theoretical ideas. We know exactly how it has to look like, and then you find an approximation. For cloaking, for electromagnetic waves, David Smith and his group at Duke built the first material for microwave frequencies, for radar frequencies, for instance. For microwaves, we use microwave all the time, and there were these circuits, was called slit ring resonators, but there are some circuits here, built in layers, and there is they put the cylinder of copper, which is very highly conducting, very hard to make it invisible. Large one was 12 centimeters long in the middle, and as I described before in the movie, the waves will go around, and this cylinder of copper could not be seen. And this movie was in YouTube for a while. I could not find it to show it here. The question is whether you can do this for light or not. And there has been a lot of work in this direction in three dimensions for the frequencies or the wavelengths of light, which is higher than microwave. The frequency of light is higher than microwave. The wavelength is smaller. Can you do that for light? In two dimensions, for very thin structure has been done, but for light has not been done. For large objects, for very small objects has been done. And there is a lot of work in different laboratories around the world trying to build the materials that will have a cloak for light. You will see it in the, of course, that will be in the front page of the newspapers.
And this is another experimental realization of the case of Smith and Dahl. This is the way right now that the Harry Potter's would look, cloak will look like. So it's a cylinder formed by these structures here.
Okay, so can do other things with the same ideas. It's the opposite. I mentioned before black hole, gravitational black holes that trap light. You cannot do experiments with black holes. So artificial black holes have been created that go around this object and are trapped here. And this group in China has done these experiments in these directions. You can do experiments with black holes, which we cannot do in the universe. Another proposal has been for water waves.
It's called tsunami cloaking. So you build these layers again, these pillars here, so water will go around and not penetrate here, protecting this region from the water. The experiments again have been done for this, uses the same ideas but for water waves. And of course, not at the scale of a city yet, but this has been successful in the laboratories, as I mentioned before. And an example that interests me is for seismic waves. I showed before earthquakes are used to find the inner structure of the earth, but they are very destructive. The question is, can we protect buildings or from seismic waves?
And there have been experiments, again, not at the scale of cities or buildings again, but by these authors, at the frequency or the wavelengths of seismic waves that have the effect of deflecting seismic waves so that it will not penetrate the object. Again, built in layers and so on. Okay, so let me finish by describing another analogy with relativity, which is wormholes. Wormholes has also attracted attention in science fiction. They are predicted by the theory of relativity that you can have a shortcut in space-time. So you can go to the future much faster
through a black hole. Instead of going this way, you can go through a black, through a wormhole much faster than otherwise. Can you do this? It has not been found in nature for gravitational, but can we do this for an electromagnetic? This is in a movie, Contact, one of my favorite science fiction movies. They did a simulation of a wormhole. Of course, we don't know whether this is true or not. No. But this is a way to go to the future. Unfortunately, you cannot go to the past. At least we don't know how, we don't have any idea how to do that. So the question is, can you build wormholes for light? Scientific American call it Harry Potter's invisibility sleeve. So can we trick the electromagnetic waves like light to function like a wormhole? So the idea is to build a cylinder here, but instead of blowing up, that transforming everything to a point, you transform everything to a line. So you blow up a line to a cylinder, and you make this part of the cylinder invisible. Here you will have light or other electromagnetic waves coming in, and you, because you can put anything you like inside, you can predict what's coming out. So you are creating a secret connection between two different points in space. This is completely invisible, this part. And these are simulations. This is invisible. The rays of light go around. You can do anything you like inside. Can wiggle a lot. Can come back. Can be trapped here. And so many effects, different effects. This is one of them, depending on what you put inside the wormhole. This is an end of the wormhole is a sphere, the other is over an infinite chessboard and under the blue sky. So you can get different effects. You can make simulations of what an electromagnetic wormhole would look like on the other side, like this. Different effects. And experimentally, recently, took only 8 years from the theory to do this. It has been built a magnetic wormhole. You have a magnetic field. This part is completely invisible to magnetic fields, and then something comes out. And what to do with a wormhole? Since I'm running out of time, let me just mention a couple of things. You can have a three-dimensional video displays. All the cables will be invisible. You can only have what's coming in and what you see. Everything else is invisible. You can have a virtual magnetic monopole. This is what it was found. So you can have a magnetic field coming in. This is invisible to magnetic fields, and something comes out. And you can manipulate what comes out. You can have invisible optical cables and many things like that. And amusing application that was suggested by these authors was to watch your back. You have bifocals, so half of the glass is in front and the other half is attached to wormholes that are invisible, but you can see everything that's coming from the back. So you can watch your back, and that can be very useful for some people. Okay, so to finish, let me say that I don't know whether you will be able to buy Harry Potter's cloak for the next Halloween. I don't know where Halloween is celebrated. Yes, it is celebrated here. And, you know, it's very hard to predict the future, but the ideas behind invisibility, the idea of transformation, optics, I'm sure will have many applications in the future. You have to use your imagination. As Arthur Clarke says, any sufficiently advanced technology, famous science fiction author, is indistinguishable from magic. Who these things, who have thought of them 30 or 50 years ago, it will look like magic. And you just have to use your imagination for the applications. So what we have seen in this lecture is some analogy between Einstein's theory of relativity and Maxwell's theory of light, electromagnetism or electromagnetic waves. So in the case of Einstein's theory, you can warp space-time by strong gravitational field. So a strong gravitational field will warp light. In optics, for light, we have found a transformation that will warp space and make light deflected. So we have a transformation from Einstein to Maxwell. Thank you.